The distribution of the texts is a particularly important and ceremonious event. It's as though the teacher is giving a personal present to each one of his students.
Envy? The future, for what it will know about the past. Wednesday.
While this first concert reading might appear a little bit exaggerated, both in intonation and in nature, it must be remembered that the students are not paying attention to the teacher at this moment. They're discovering the text. They're seeing the written words. They are using their highlighters in order to pick out any words that are particularly interesting to them. And the teacher's voice is only coming to them through peripheral perception. The entire ceremony of the first concert reading, through which we present all new material, has been designed to support the words that they're reading.
I am Thornton Thunder. I am from Thurso. At the farthest point north in Scotland, I'm a jack of all trades and master of many. During our 4 weeks together, we will be learning more about the human mind and the marvelous things it is capable of. We will become familiar with the intellectual, emotional, and technological resources at our disposal.
While the decoding session is somewhat traditional in format, in that it's the teacher giving information to the students, it's during this phase of the Suggestopedic cycle that students come into contact with some of the fundamental cultural tenets of the new language and develop a respect and, above all, an enjoyment of the form of humor that characterizes that civilization.
Usually we say I'm a jack of all trades and master of absolutely Thornton, but Thornton, who of course knows this expression, is a master of many.
Every now and then, the explanations are a little bit far-fetched, even if not totally historically inaccurate. Students don't seem to mind this. They seem to know, in fact, when the teacher is joking and when real information is being conveyed.
Okay? If you're happy, you cheer. Hooray! And if you're not happy, you go boo. Can you boo? Do you want to try booing? Boo! Okay, alright. I think you probably seem to boo a little better than you actually cheer. Maybe you've had more practice booing than cheering. Okay.
The acquisition of this new way of seeing things and new form of humor is precisely what makes it possible for the student to develop new aspects of his personality through the knowledge he's assimilating. This is one of the strongest motivational factors in a learning experience.
Perhaps one of the most horrible things is listening to Bach when Bach is played as if he were Debussy. Can you imagine that? There's a terrible joke. I just can't. It's not in very good taste, but I just...
Jokes are very important in the Suggestopedic classroom, not only because they give linguistic information, but because jokes usually involve a surprise. And in actual fact, from a neurophysiological point of view, a joke is the short-circuiting of the left and right hemispheres, because the beginning of a joke always starts off straightforwardly enough with something which is perfectly logical in one context, and then all of a sudden we find ourselves in another context. The left hemisphere is the rational, predictable, mathematical part of our personalities, and the right hemisphere is the spatio-temporal aspect of our lives, and it's this which is shifted and makes people laugh.
It's okay. Yes? It's a story about a snobbish lady, a very, very snobbish lady, who went up to see the French conductor, Pierre Boulez, and said, "Ah, Mr. Boulez, how are you?" And he didn't know her. He says, "Fine, thank you, madam. And how is good Mrs. Boulez?" "She's very well, thank you, madam." And the woman was very snobbish, but a little ignorant. And she said, "And how is dear Mr. Bach? Is he still composing?" And he said, "No, madam, he's still decomposing." And it's not very good taste, but I just couldn't resist telling you. I'm sorry, I promise not to tell you any more jokes like that. Yeah, and sometimes if you're from the South, "I'm American, I'm American, I'm American,
I'm American,
okay, I'm American, good, okay, oh, that's fantastic, okay, and I'm English,
I'm English,
okay, I'm Irish,
I'm Irish,
okay, we put all the words together in English, I'm Irish, everybody,
I'm Irish,
good, okay, any other nationalities?"
One of the most effective means of working on pronunciation particularities is by introducing a situation which is just so outrageous that nobody can possibly feel any guilt about having made a mistake.
I'm from Ames. Because we have two sounds in English. Everybody. And. Now, the difference is. No vocal cords, and zzz is with the vocal cords. Okay, and if you want to have more fun than you might have had since the age of 18 months, I've got a terrific game for you. It's makes you sound a little bit like a boat, but it's great fun, and people know you're coming 5 minutes before you arrive, okay? All right?
In this particular case, the problem is that in Dutch there doesn't seem to be a zzz sound.
Sometimes with our S's, we say like book, books. Everybody?
Books.
Okay, but with bag, a g is just a k with the vocal cords. It's bags.
Bags.
Everybody?
Bags.
Okay, fantastic. And I have a little story for you. Do you know the story about the mummy mosquito and the baby mosquito?
No.
You don't know the story about the mummy mosquito and the baby mosquito? Really? Okay, I'm going to tell you the story about the mummy mosquito and the baby mosquito. Okay, but can you go zzz? Okay, here, let me take the ball from you here, okay? Okay, fine. And it's a story about a mummy mosquito. And one day, mummy mosquito says to the baby mosquito, "Baby mosquito, you're a big boy now."
Another positive spin-off of telling jokes is that people are delighted when they actually understand them and are quite anxious to pass them on to friends, family, or other associates. Many students begin making jokes of their own, thereby becoming creative in the language that they're in the process of learning.
I think this is the most exciting day of my life.